Elder Robert Dean Hales was born to J. Roulon and Vera Marie Holbrook Hales on August 24, 1932. The youngest of three children, he has a brother Gerald and a sister Janet. Elder Hales was born in New York City and grew up in nearby Long Island. He is currently 80 years old. Every summer, Vera Hales took the children to stay with Grandma and Grandpa Holbrook in Bountiful, Utah. Spending time there with their cousins helped them grow close like brothers and sisters. Elder Hales spent two summers with his cousins on their ranch in Skull Valley, Utah. There they baled hay, rode horses, and took salt licks up into the mountains for the cattle. In remembering those summers, Elder Hales said, "Those were great times."
As a young boy, Elder Hales learned to play the piano. Wondering if he still enjoys playing? The answer is yes, but he would tell you, only if no one is listening.
When Robert was 12 years old, his father took him to visit the church historical sites. In the sacred grove, they knelt and prayed together. His father spoke to him of sacred things, and together they dedicated their lives to that which that would keep them together for eternity. Later, his father, a commercial artist, painted him a picture of the sacred grove. Elder Hales said, "I've always hung that picture in my office, and when I look at it, I remember my father and our talk that summer afternoon."
As a young boy, Elder Hales loved everything about baseball. He spent a great deal of time practicing. As a freshman in high school, he was the starting pitcher for the school's varsity baseball team. One season, he hit a slump and lost three games in a row. The headline in the school paper read, "Hard Luck Hales Loses Again." Feeling as though he was letting the team down, he took his uniform to the coach and told him he was going to quit. Once in the office, the coach said, "Do you know why you're losing? Your pitching arm is tired at the end of the game, because before the game, when you're supposed to be warming up, you're out there impressing everybody with your fastball. You probably pitch two or three innings doing that. Quit showing off, and you won't wear out your arm." Elder Hales listened, thought about what his coach had said, and the next game pitched a shutout. From this experience, Elder Hales said the following, "That's why you love a coach who will tell you what you need to hear. If you listen to your coach, you can avoid repeating your mistakes and have a better opportunity to achieve your goals. The Lord is like that too. I don't get tired of the chastening of the Lord or of the Lord's anointed."
Elder Hales had the unique opportunity of having the United Nations included in his high school district. He said, "I really learned about other countries from the children of the UN representatives. I decided then that I wanted to have an international experience in my life."
During the summer following his sophomore year of college, Elder Hales met Mary Crandall in a Queens ward in New York City. Mary's family had recently moved from Los Angeles, California. Elder Hales said, "After I met her, I never went out with anyone else." At the end of the summer, they both returned to college in Utah, Robert to the University of Utah and Mary to BYU. On June 10, 1953, they were married in the Salt Lake Temple. They have been married 60 years. Together, they have two sons, Stephen, born in 1955, and David, born in 1958.
Elder Hales reached the age of going on a mission during the Korean War. The mission home was closed for a time and only a limited number of young men were called to serve full-time missions. Elder Hales was not called to serve a full-time mission as a young man. He said, "When I was deciding how to proceed with my life as a college student during the Korean War, I had the privilege of meeting with an apostle, Elder Harold B. Lee. He told me, 'The Lord will have you serve your mission in the military.'"
Shortly after graduation, Elder Hales entered the United States Air Force, where he served 4 years as a jet fighter pilot in the Strategic and Tactical Air Commands. He flew F-84s and F-100 jets. In the military, each squadron chooses a motto for their unit. Elder Hales says, Our unit motto was Return with Honor. This motto was a constant reminder to us of our determination to return to our home base with honor after we have expended all of our efforts to successfully complete every aspect of our mission. It continues to be a reminder to him as he shares the idea that we should all be mindful to return with honor to our homes, both in heaven and on earth. When each of his sons left on their missions, he lovingly embraced them and whispered, "Return with honor."
When Robert finished his active duty service in the Air Force, the family moved to Cambridge, Massachusetts, where he attended Harvard. He graduated in 1960 with a Master of Business Administration degree.
Elder Robert D. Hales was called to be the Elder's Quorum President while he was attending school at Harvard University. He was fine accepting the call, but was concerned because he knew the professors discouraged extra activities as the program was so intense. He said, after much prayer and discussion, Sister Hales said, "I'd rather have an active priesthood holder than a man who holds a master's degree from Harvard. We'll do them both." Mary has continued to be a great support in Elder Hales' nearly 60 years of church callings. Through Elder Hales' early years after being the Elder's Quorum President, he served as a branch president, bishop, High Counselor, State President's Counselor, Mission President of the England-London Mission in the late 1970s, First Counselor in the Sunday School General Presidency, and a Regional Representative.
During his professional business career, Hales held executive positions with four major national companies. After joining the Gillette Company, he became President of Papermate, a division of Gillette. Then he joined Max Factor as a vice president and later headed Hughes Television Network. Just prior to his call to be a general authority, he was president of Cheeseboro Ponds. Over the years, the family lived in several countries as well as several locations in the United States. He has indeed been able to have the international experience he desired in his youth. After much encouragement from family and friends, Elder Hales wrote a book titled Return. It was published in 2010 by Deseret Book.
In 1975, Elder Hales was in a board meeting when his secretary handed him a note saying President Marion G. Romney, second counselor in the first presidency, was on the phone. Robert surprised board members when he left the meeting to take the call. President Romney asked him to serve as a mission president. Then, a short time later, President Spencer W. Kimball, president of the church then, called to ask if he wouldn't mind going on a different mission. He extended a call to Robert D. Hales to serve for the rest of his life as a general authority of the church. Elder Hales served as an assistant to the Quorum of the 12 Apostles and later as a member of the First Quorum of the 70. After 3 years as a general authority, Elder Hales was called as president of the England-London Mission. Following that service, he was assigned as an area supervisor in Europe and worked closely with Elder Thomas S. Monson of the Quorum of the 12 Apostles, now president of the church, in supporting and strengthening Latter-day Saints in Czechoslovakia, East Germany, Hungary, and Poland. From 1983 to 1984, Elder Hales served as area president of the North America Southwest area. In 1985, he was called to serve as presiding bishop and served in that calling until he was sustained as an apostle in 1994. Elder Robert D. Hales was called and ordained to serve as an apostle of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints by President Ezra Taft Benson in April of 1994.
My dear brothers and sisters, I shall now present to you the general authorities and general auxiliary presidencies of the Church for your sustaining vote. It is proposed that we sustain Howard W. Hunter as President of the Council of the 12 Apostles, and the following as members of that Council: Howard W. Hunter, Richard G. Scott, and Robert D. Hales. In view of the call of Bishop Robert D. Hales as a member of the Council of the 12, becomes necessary to release him as the presiding bishop. Those who wish to join us in a vote of appreciation to Bishop Hales and his counselors H. David Burton and Richard C. Edgley, please manifest it. It appears that the voting has been unanimous in the affirmative. We now invite the newly sustained Member of the 12, members of the 70, and presiding bishop to take their places on the stand.
I put myself in the Lord's hands when I made that decision to serve, Elder Hale says now, many years later. Putting themselves in the Lord's hands is a pattern Elder and Sister Hales have followed throughout their life together. They are a team committed to balancing family life, church service, and career. And because they established that pattern early in their marriage, it was much easier to accept additional callings later on.
In rare moments when Elder Hales gets to relax, he still enjoys sports, especially playing golf. He tries to keep in touch with the sports world by watching previously recorded snippets whenever he gets the chance. He adores spending time with his grandchildren. He likes to take them on adventures and outings, like to a bird refuge or hiking, while Mary likes to read to them.
Elder Hales says, "My mother taught me, if the Lord wants you to be a ball player, you will be. Follow where the Spirit takes you. I have often pondered what would have happened in my life if I had chosen to pursue a baseball career. If I had been successful in that athletic career, I would never have had all the other exciting opportunities I had to work for the international companies and, most important, to serve the Lord to the extent that has been my privilege. Sometimes unrealized dreams or prayers not answered in the way we hoped are blessings in disguise that fulfill eternal purposes in our lives. There will be times in our lives when things don't go as we plan, but the Lord's plan is greater than we can even dream." I loved this little story. It is so powerful. We may have a big dream when we are young, but we do not know what the Lord has in store for us. Following the Spirit is so important in making decisions. If we do, then who knows where or what we could be doing.
My favorite teaching by Elder Hales comes from his April 2010 conference address titled, "Our Duty to God, the Mission of Parents and Leaders to the Rising Generation." Elder Hales teaches that it is important to pay attention to your youth by asking them questions, letting them talk, and being willing to listen. He tells a story about his young grandson. "Several years ago, I was reading the newspaper when one of my young grandsons snuggled up to me. As I read, I was delighted to hear his sweet voice chattering on in the background. Imagine my surprise when a few moments later, he pushed himself between me and the paper. Taking my face in his hands and pressing his nose up to mine, he asked, 'Grandpa, are you in there? Mother, father, are you in there? Grandpa, grandma, are you there?' Being there means understanding the hearts of our youth and connecting with them. Connecting with them means not just conversing with them, but doing things with them too."
The teaching I most enjoyed from Elder Hales comes from his April 2010 General Conference address titled, "Our Duty to God, the Mission of Parents and Leaders to the Rising Generation." Elder Hales encourages parents to spend time with their children and talk with them about their hopes and dreams. He encouraged us to tell our children we love them and to take advantage of teaching moments as they come along. He said that it is impossible to overestimate the influence of parents who understand the hearts of their children. We are their greatest influence. This talk has helped me to realize that what I have to say to my own children is important. And most importantly, when they want to talk with me, I had better be ready to listen, because they have something important to say as well. Elder Hales said, "Listen and listen some more. Hearken with spiritual ears."
While serving in the Air Force as an F-100 fighter pilot, Lieutenant Hales got some very good advice from a wise and experienced trainer. Seeing that his boots were not laced up correctly, the trainer said, "No, this is how you lace them up." Elder Hales couldn't see why this was so important, but his instructor seemed to know what he was talking about. As he was shown the proper way to lace, the trainer explained, "You don't know when you'll need to come out of that airplane, and when you do, you don't want to ruin your career because you can't walk anymore." He was right. That very day, while sitting on the tarmac in his F-100 single-seat fighter craft, a fire warning light came on. His plane was on fire, and his training told him he only had 10 seconds to get out of the plane. Using the emergency protocol, he vaulted out of the cockpit to the ground 15 feet below. The laced-up boots saved his career. The lesson learned? In life, how we respond to wise counsel, even if we don't understand the importance of it, can prepare us for life's tests.
So many of Elder Hales' stories and lessons touched my heart and inspired me, I found it difficult to choose one. The lessons that inspired me most are, listen to the ones who know, don't let the bad things that happen keep you from moving forward, and the importance of preparation. Russell Wilson, quarterback for the Seattle Seahawks, says, "The separation's in the preparation." I know Elder Hales would agree. In his book Return, he says, "We are always preparing." Of the experience with his plane catching fire, Elder Hales states, "Fear of a fire is not what got me out of the plane successfully. It was the preparation and preconditioning to act, without having to think in the moment, under stress, about what I should do to save my life." Elder Hales has separated himself from the things of the world by preparing spiritually for the things of eternity. He has listened to the ones who know, and he has continued to move forward in spite of the bad things that have happened. From his examples, we learn that in every aspect of our lives, we are daily preparing to return with honor. He says, "Think of your life on earth as preparation for eternity. Preparation is for everyone, young and old. It is a way of life filled with wonder, adventure, challenge, opportunity, and the possibility of miracles as we are led by a loving Heavenly Father through His Spirit on our journey home."
I have a great love for the scriptures. I love reading about the mortal life of Jesus Christ. There is so much in his life that can lift and inspire and strengthen us in our times of need. To me, one of the most sacred chapters in all the scriptures is John chapter 17. The entire chapter is an intercessory prayer offered by Jesus Christ to his Father. He says, in effect, "If only the world could know you as I know you." He tells his Father that he has done everything he has been asked to do. Sometimes we forget how remarkably obedient the Savior was. Everything that he did, everything that he said, was out of obedience to his Father. His seeking out and caring for the poor, the calling of his disciples, his teaching both in the land of Palestine and in the Americas, all these things were done because his Father had commanded him to do them. He had no personal agenda. He said, "I do nothing of myself, but as my Father hath taught me." What a perfect example of obedience. In the choices we make in life, we need to know the Savior. His simple admonition, "Come, follow me," could transform human existence if we would let it. He has the power to make our burdens light if we will turn to Him. As an apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ, I have the opportunity to bear testimony as a sacred witness of the Savior. My greatest desire is that my testimony might penetrate the hearts of those who hear it. I know that Jesus Christ lives. I know that He guides and directs His church by revelation through His prophet in this very day and time. If we will have faith in our Savior, He will see us through our trials and tribulations, and we will be able to endure to the end and return to His presence after this mortal probation. He lives and knows and loves each one of us. He so much wants to bless us, if we will come unto him. Of this I bear humble testimony and witness. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.